All right. Good afternoon. How's everyone doing? Good. Good. All right. Nice to hang out with you. Nice to see you. So my name is Jeff Bucholtz, and what I do is violence prevention work. I go to high schools and colleges and military bases all across the country, and I talk about things like sexual assault, and I talk about things like domestic or dating violence, and I talk about things like stalking. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. We're actually going to be focused more on how we talk about relationships. So we end violence, just so you know, doesn't mean like I go around like we, like superheroes or something, try to end violence, but really is about the idea that we, like you and me together, have a lot of ability to do something about this and prevent violence before it happens. And so that's kind of what we're gonna look at today. And actually, I didn't need to grab some stuff. So any of you been exposed before to or know what the words domestic violence mean? When I say domestic violence, dating violence, what do you think? What do you think I'm talking about? Tell me. Not a trick question. What am I talking about? Yes, sir.
Fighting and going too far.
A couple fighting and going too far. And what would be too far?
Phone breaking, poles getting smashed against doors.
Okay. All right. People getting physically hurt. What else? When I say when I say relationship abuse, what do you think? What do you think, sir? What does that mean? Yes, you.
Calling names.
Huh?
Calling names.
Calling names. Okay. So and with what end? I mean, like just like being like, hey, sweetie. So hurting, so deliberately doing what? You were on it, deliberately using words to hurt their feelings, good. What else? Anyone else have a theory? Abuse, and what would that look like?
Hitting them.
Physically abusing them. How many of you have known a friend, or known a family member, or anyone anywhere ever, who was in an unhealthy relationship, or had an unhealthy relationship? All right, so that's that side of the room very lucky. But most of us have actually known someone or been around abuse before. And so I just want to kind of point that out because it's a kind of relevant thing. Actually, we have a sponsor for this event. I'm not sure if you knew, there's like a couple of sponsors. I'm going to read one of the ads from them right now. They're one of our sponsors here.
In a home where not everything is as perfect as it seems, he will discover something that she doesn't want him to. Frustration will mount. Conflict will begin. And in a moment when he is angry and she is defensive, in a moment when he doesn't want to hear excuses and she doesn't want to admit to making a mistake, they will talk. He will tell her what is bothering him. She will apologize and explain her frustration. He will listen. In a home where not everything is as perfect as it seems, they will talk openly, they will talk respectfully, and they will avert disaster. Coming soon to a theater near you, open communication.
It's an ad. I don't know if it was an ad for this. Yeah? Get it? It's an ad. That's a good ad. So what's my point? You think?
Talk it out.
Talk it out. Have you heard people say things before like relationships are just really hard? Love is hard. Love is painful. Love hurts. You ever heard this before? Should it hurt? Is it really that hard? If you have a problem with someone, what do you do to solve that problem? Talk about it. And you talk in a way that's open and honest and respectful, and usually you can solve the problems. How many of you think that's realistic? That if you are open and honest and respectful with people that you know, you can actually solve problems? Show of hands. Right? I mean, it's a pretty simple solution. But yet in our culture, the way we talk about it is like, oh, no, that's never going to happen. Another way I can do this for you right now is to kind of look at different kinds of relationships. So let's look at and explore different kinds of relationships. We got fun relationships, okay? We've got awkward relationships. We've got annoying relationships. And then we've got relationships that, for lack of a better term, are just O-V-E-R, right? They're just done. You're over with them. And then maybe at the end, we'd have like abusive relationships or abusive situations. So when I say fun, what makes a relationship fun? You would say what? Say what? Going out and doing stuff with friends, okay? Oh, you're just scratching yourself, okay. Good, glad you got that taken care of. That's it? That's all that's fun, is hanging out. You can't tell me anything else that's positive or fun about a relationship.
Just being to each other is enough.
Say what?
Being
to each other is enough. So you just sit down next to each other, and that's fun. Just hanging out. What makes you like someone? Like, what do they do that makes you enjoy them? What about their personality? You are like vague. This is like, if I was your teacher and you were writing this in an essay, it'd be F, 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 because you're like so vague. What is it that makes people fun? What is it that makes relationships interesting? What do you do with people?
Take them on a date,
okay?
Communicate.
About what?
Their
lives and what, and so like people, so what would make a relationship fun? When you can communicate about like similar interests maybe?
Yeah.
Okay, good, good, good. See, simple, right? What else? You enjoy people that make you?
Laugh.
Good. See, you do have answers to these questions, right? You enjoy people that make you laugh. Are there people, what else makes a relationship fun or positive? You're able to do what?
Anything.
And what do you mean by anything? Like you're able to do anything because you can do what? You have what in the other person?
Trust,
faith in the other person, right? So when all of these things are pieces of what fun relationships are, and here I'm asking you, and you're like, you just hang up. But it's like, that's not, I mean, come on, that's not like really what makes a relationship good. There's actually things that make a difference, right? I mean, like, you're like, oh, just hang out. But you don't just hang out with everyone, you know? Like, you hang out with people who you enjoy, who are kind to you. How many of you are like, you know who I really want to hang out with right now? Someone who will totally make me feel like crap. Right? And very few of you will do that. I mean, maybe you would think like there's some people you have to do that with, you know, like your brother or something, you know, like who makes you feel bad. But I mean, you don't choose people like that. You don't enter into relationships most often with people that make you feel that way. There are positive things out there. Now say or awkward. What's awkward? Awkward.
When the girlfriend's taller than the boyfriend.
The girlfriend's taller than the boyfriend. Why is that awkward?
Because the girl's never supposed to be taller than the boy.
The girl's never supposed to be taller than the boy. Wow, I should tell some of my friends about that. I have friends who are married. They've been happily married for like 15 years. But okay, so the standard, right? Who sets the standard?
Society.
And where do you think you got the picture? You said a picture. Where's that picture from? Pinterest, media, right? I mean, so think about it, right? Like you're using a standard. Does that standard, I mean, like what if you really love someone and, you know, let's say you fall in love with someone who's shorter than you. Are you saying you're like, it never happened, right? He's so nice, he's rich, he likes everything that I like, we laugh together, we have fun together, but he's 2 inches shorter than me, done. Never gonna happen, right? I mean, so maybe that would be awkward. What else is awkward in a relationship?
When they can't,
so like, have you ever had maybe gone on a date, or like you hung out with someone and the conversation went kind of like this?
Or they're on the phone all the time, that's really freaking annoying.
When they're what?
On their phone all the time.
Okay, so that's someone's on the phone all the time. You ever been in a conversation where there was nothing to talk about?
Yeah,
and that can be pretty awkward, yeah? Anything else that's awkward? People who are on their phone all the time, that might be annoying more than awkward. What else? Anything else you think I want to say awkward? What was that?
When a girl has a deeper voice than you.
Wow. I'm gonna stop what we're doing right now and we're gonna do something different because you all need this conversation. We're gonna put this on pause. I'm gonna come back to this in a minute. I wanna start with something different now. All right, I'm gonna ask you a couple questions. I'm gonna draw on the board up here. I'm gonna put like the male sign and the female sign. And I'm going to ask you to tell me, if I say, act like a real man is what? I want you to tell me what a real man is, what he's supposed to be like.
Put your hand down.
But what would that be, that you can fly? Is that what that was? You're flexing. Okay, so give me a word that would describe that. A real man's supposed to be? Good. Strong.
Sensitive.
What else? Huh?
Faithful.
When I say act like so has money?
No.
I'm asking you, but see, you're saying no, but 2 seconds ago you just said that guys can't be shorter than girls or that's not romantic. And 2 seconds ago, right, someone just said like, you can't have a deeper voice. So don't BS me. I don't want you to tell me what you think I want to hear. I don't want you to tell me what you think the right answer is. I want you to tell me what you really believe and what you hear around you. I'm going to ask you again. What does a real man act like? We say act like a man, be a real man. What are we saying? What do we mean? He should be what?
Fearless.
Fearless. A lumberjack. Fearless, brave, tough. What else you got?
Caring.
Okay. What else you got?
Emotional.
Emotional?
No.
They have to show emotion? A real man show, what emotion is a real man supposed to show? Do they cry? Have a coke and a smile. Listen, I'm asking you to do something, and what you're doing right now is really interesting to me. Because a moment ago, you were throwing stereotypes at me like you couldn't find enough of them. And now I'm asking you to tell me, stereotypes, and you're like, no. I'm gonna tell you things that I think aren't stereotypes, right? I wanna know what you're thinking, right? I mean, you're telling me that that a guy on this campus, if he shows an emotion of real sensitivity and caring, people are gonna be like, he's a real man.
No.
Now, maybe you would wish that was the case. Maybe I would wish that that was the case. But are you really telling me that that's what it's like in your high school? That a guy who cries is going to be thought of as a real man? Okay. So you would say emotion, right? But let's be honest. Are guys supposed to show lots of emotion?
No.
You said a lumberjack. So guys are supposed to be able to do things that are what? Like... Yeah, like manly, but handy, right? Like supposed to be handy, be able to fix things. Tell me if you think I'm off base, right? As a guy, like when you grow up as a man, like what are you supposed to be able to do for your family? Provide and support. If I asked you what like a real high school guy is always thinking about, what would you say? Chicks. Now, thankfully, that's not true. We're not always thinking about sex. But nonetheless, so here's some good stereotypes to start. Let's move over here to women. I say a real woman, like feminine women, right? A woman who's like supposed to be the best of everything that is a woman. What is she supposed to do or be like?
Sweet.
She's supposed to be sweet. What else?
Pretty.
What else?
Good sense of humor.
Okay. Maybe. She's what? I hear what you said. Anything? That's what you got. Sweet, pretty, and funny. A good cook. Good with kids. So we'll put like nurturing, right? Nurturing. A mother. I've got cooking. Makeup, okay, so supposed to be like makeup and beauty. Fashionable. Quiet. That's what someone just said, quiet. Anything else? I just shouted it out, I didn't say it. Okay, so they're quiet. Well, they're quiet, but they're, I mean, we're not talking about like being like volume loud. Are women supposed to like take over and be in charge of everything? No. So when you say quiet, is there another word you might be able to use to sub in for that? Starts with an S. Submissive. Okay. Patient and understanding. Let me ask you a question. If in your high school, okay, if in this high school, someone does not fit into this kind of like this list, if a guy is not like these things, what is the consequence?
They're not a real man.
Okay, but they're not a real man. What's the consequence though? Say what?
Taunted.
Okay, so.
They end up alone.
Taunted, okay, they're gonna be alone. What else?
Made fun of.
And can you give me some examples of how they'd be made fun of? So to get called names, give me some names that guys are gonna get called if they're not tough. Pussy. Go ahead, what else you got? Gay. Weird. Fag. A homo, a bitch,
a
Tell me this. Are there like serious potential consequences to not being those things?
I mean, they can lead to serious potential consequences.
Okay, and that's what I just asked you. Are there serious potential consequences?
Fights.
And what would they be? Fights? Okay. So is there a possibility that they might be attacked even? They might get in a fight, they might be bullied. Are those realistic possibilities?
Yes.
So violence, bullying,
suicide,
absolutely. Okay, so what about for women? If they don't do these things, if they don't meet those things, if they're not beautiful and they're not submissive, what are they gonna be called? Okay, so they're gonna be taunted as well. Slut. A dyke. A whore. Not important. Basic? Okay. Huh? Easy. Women who stand up for themselves and are assertive are going to get called what?
That's not manly.
I didn't say it was. Hold it. Give me a second, okay? Slow down. They're going to get called what? They're going to call a femme, really? Okay. I'll give you a hint. There's a word over there that you shouted out that women get called all the time when they argue and are assertive. Yeah. Bitch.
Snob.
Okay. Are there potential consequences? Are there potential, like, real life serious consequences for not fitting in, like, not being like that? Okay, so is bullying again another consequence? Okay, and violence. So bullying. Could they be what?
Abused,
yeah.
Depression.
You said could they be abused, and that's your spot on. Why were you thinking that?
Because like if they don't meet everybody else's
standards. Hey! Listen.
Because if they don't meet everybody else's standards, couldn't they be like verbally and physically abused by other people?
So if they don't meet other standards, right? Maybe they're not meeting the standards of even their like boyfriend or their spouse, right? Their husband, something like that. Could they actually be abused as a result of that? Yeah. I've met women who were beat to with almost an inch of their life because the food they prepared was prepared late and was cold. I've met women who were beat to within an inch of their life because they were not listening or nurturing enough to their spouse in his mind. So yes, abuse, for sure, could be on that. That's a very astute observation, right? Abuse. Now, it's not abuse. What if I said the word rape? Just being these things, right? Or maybe like one of these words, potentially lead to rape. How? Why?
They take advantage of.
They get taken advantage of. Why?
Because they
put themselves out there. But I mean, what does that even mean?
Dressing a certain way.
So a woman who dresses a certain way deserves to be raped.
Well, no. It's just how they dress.
Oh, it's the how they dress. Okay. Yeah.
I don't think that rape is based on what girls wear. I think girls that aren't the submissive type that, you know, stand up for themselves, that's when they get raped, because boys feel that they need to take control.
Okay, so rape maybe happens as a result of people wanting control and power over someone, yeah? If you are thought of as being sweet and submissive, and that all you're supposed to be is beautiful, and that you're basically an object, does that make it more likely that someone will see you as a potential rape victim? Does calling someone a slut make it more likely that they will be seen as rapeable? Yeah, I'll prove it to you. Finish this sentence. That slut got what she
deserved.
You just said some women deserve to be raped. You understand that? I mean, literally, what you just said, when you say that slut got what she, and you all just went, deserved, like you knew it. You realize that word literally makes it seem like some women deserve to be raped. And which women? Well, how do you know who is a slut and who isn't? Who gets to choose?
Yourself.
You choose? So you choose. Oh, the person chooses for themselves. Okay, but you just said you could be called a slut for what?
Any reason.
Why would you be called a slut? In this school, why do girls get called sluts?
The way they act.
Okay, but what about the way they act? They flirt with every guy. Okay, so she just goes around and flirts with like every dude on campus. Okay, all right. What else could she get called a slut for? You dress like a slut. What does that look like?
Short
shorts. Okay. How many women in this room have ever worn a pair of shorts? Show of hands. So you're saying you're all sluts?
No, it's not like that.
Oh, it's not like that. Okay, so how many women in this room? Okay, how many women in this room? How many people in this room? How many women in this room have ever worn anything that showed any cleavage, even like a little bit at all? Show of hands. So you're saying that you're sluts. How many ways can a girl get called a slut on this campus?
2005.
Well, okay, 2005. What you're saying is that every girl on your campus basically is going to get labeled this at some point, aren't they? It doesn't matter what they say. It doesn't matter what they wear. It doesn't matter who they sleep with or don't sleep with, because you can get called a slut for not sleeping with someone. You can get called a slut for just flirting with someone. You can get called a slut for literally basically standing still and being a woman. On your campus, what you're telling me is that basically all women are sluts. And who gets to choose? Whoever. That word is not a word. You are talking about a system that puts women at risk. This is not, I'm not like making stuff up here. You're telling me that the real consequences of what this is are not just name calling, but name calling that can quite literally lead to violence, to things like rape and abuse in relationships. Do these things put pressure on us to be this way?
Yeah.
Yes. So really what we're doing is creating a gigantic box. And inside this box, we say, you get in the box. It's kind of a messed up box now. But you get in the box. And if you're not in the box, what's going to happen? All of these negative things. So I want to point this out to you, because just a minute ago when I was starting with this, you guys were shouting out things that pushed people into a box. And if the box, like, I mean, are the things on the side, are they bad? Like, are these real things that you've seen in school that you think aren't good?
Yeah.
I mean, like, is this real?
Yeah,
it's totally real. So my question for you is, why would you put someone in the box if none of you really like being in the box? Which is what started to happen when I asked this question. I said, what is a woman supposed to be like? And immediately you started arguing. You were like, no, she's not supposed to be like that. She's supposed to be like this. I feel like the passion, right? But the idea here is that as soon as I asked, you were like, no, no box. Box is stupid. But a minute before, you shoved people in a box. All of us spend time shoving people in the box, and then we don't like being in the box because the box feels like crap. And if you get out of the box, it feels even worse. How many times have any of you used one of those words? How many times have you been the victim of those words? Right? Why? Why would you do that to each other when you hate it yourself? Why would you use those words and push people into a box that you have identified is not just unhealthy, it's dangerous. Wouldn't they want to admit they do it? Yeah. But you know you do it. So I'm asking you to stop. Why would you push each other in this box? You know and I know that the box is unhealthy. You know and I know that the box is flat out dangerous. You know and I know that we hate being in the box because we're more than what's in this box, right? Like, yeah, guys should be able to be emotional about anything we want to be. Guys, I mean, when we say guys can get dirty and girls have to be clean, you know, I'm like, what the hell's that? Well, I mean, we don't like being in the box because it limits who you can be. It limits you. I mean, we're American, right? The whole idea is like, be yourself. But every time you use these words, every time you push someone into the box, you are saying, be who I want you to be. And that's not healthy, and no one likes that. I'm not saying you're bad people. I've been in high schools all over the country. I've done this in my life. It's because no one pointed it out to you. Well, here I am pointing it out to you. And I'm asking you to do yourselves a favor. Don't push people in the box. When you say something like, I know you were being kind of playful, right? When you say something like a girl has a deeper voice than a guy, you literally just pushed girls into a box and you pushed boys into a box. Not because you were trying to be mean or because you were like, I want someone to get raped. I know that's not what you were about, right? I know that. But you understand now that even when you did that, that the potential consequences exist even if you didn't mean for them to, or you didn't mean for them to, or you didn't mean for them to. It's not about just what you mean for it to be. It lives in a world where there are real consequences. I asked you to identify how many of you knew someone who was in an unhealthy relationship, and almost all of you raised your hands. This is not fiction. Y'all are in a criminal justice class, for heaven's sake. You're studying crime. This is why it happens. You understand, crime doesn't just happen because of like magic, there's just bad people in the world. We let it happen. Most violent crime occurs between people who know each other. It occurs inside of families. It occurs between best friends. Most violent crime occurs between people who trust each other. And this is part of why. It's not the only reason, but it's part of why. I want to come back to where I started. We wrote annoying relationships. I'm going to talk about annoying. And I'm not even going to continue along this line. I'm just going to tell you what I think, and then we'll finish this up for a second, because I think I want to kind of get back on track with some of the stuff I want to talk about today. Fun, awkward, annoying. Annoying, you know, people who just get on your nerves, right? I mean, there's all kinds of things your friends do that piss you off, and sometimes they get, you know, you're like, you suck, you're annoying me. I might be annoying you now, for example. Over, O-V-E-R, right? It's just so over, right? I mean, that's like, you know, lying, cheating, stealing. Those kind of things, right, usually lead to you saying, I'm done with this relationship. I want it to be over. Then over here, we've got this idea of abusive. Abusive relationships. And what I want to ask you is abuse the same as these other kinds of relationships? No. Okay. Why? What makes it different? I'll agree with you. It's not. It really doesn't even belong up here. So I'm going to ask you why. Why is it not the same?
Because abuse is more damage to a person.
Okay, so abuse, I mean, like, all of us can get annoyed and be, or have a bad relationship and break up, but abuse hurts people in a way that is different than most relationships would be, right? What else is different about abuse? Yeah, there's a lot of different forms of it. Yeah, absolutely. What else? Yeah. It's not even really a relationship. Excellent. Why? You're spot on. Why?
Well, because a relationship kind of helps you find, like, it helps you get through stuff.
Brilliant. What's your name?
Gabe Johnson.
Huh?
Gabe Johnson.
Gabe. Gabe Johnson, well answered. Right? That is a great answer, Gabe. You said in real relationships, why do you get into a relationship? Because you're trying to create something positive. It's good, right? You're trying to create something good. In most relationships, people enter into it so both of them can benefit from it in some way, right? I mean, like, yeah, you're entering into it to benefit for yourself, but you also want the other person to benefit. That's the whole idea of a relationship. Any of your friendships, you hang out because you're fun for them, they're fun for you, right? That's good times. In abuse, one person is there for themselves. They are not there to create fun for both people. They are there for themselves and for themselves alone. And that is about power and control. One person comes into the relationship, and they're in the relationship because what they want to do is feel like they can feel good about themselves, so they can feel like they have strength, or they can feel like they're in charge. And the way they do this is by controlling and hurting the other person. Think about it. You've all had a friend, right, who you probably stopped being friends with at some point because they put you down a lot. And why do they do that? Why do we say bullies bully? Because really deep down, they don't feel good about who?
Themselves.
They're feeling a need, and that need is to feel powerful, to feel like there's something in their life that's good. So what they do is they put you and you and you down, or in a relationship, they hurt their partner. When I hit you, and I'm dating you, and I hit you, who feels powerful? Me. When you're getting beat up, you don't feel powerful. When someone's telling you how stupid you are every day, you don't feel powerful, but the other person can. Yeah, that's the difference. These are not the same thing. And it was an astute observation, as you'd had a very astute observation about abuse over here, right? And your name was?
Michelle.
Michelle, that's my sister's name, good name. That is a really astute observation too, Michelle. Look, I'm gonna see if I can show you kind of like how dominant the idea here is. And we're gonna do a little sing-along now. Okay, so I'm gonna put a song up here. I'm gonna expect you all to sing the song out loud. Even if you don't know it, you can just karaoke it with me here. It should be playing. It's a good song, a famous song, by Black Eyed Peas. Night and day, remember this one? I'm addicted, wanna jump inside your love. Remember, come on, sing it, Fergie. I wouldn't wanna have it any other way. I'm addicted and I just can't get enough. So what? I just can't get enough. You can just read this. I just can't get enough. You can read it. Read it. I just can't get enough. There's so many things to say earlier. Nothing now. Get enough. Right? Ready? Solo? She give the hotness a new meaning. Perfection, mommy, you gleaming. Inception, you got a brother dreaming. No? Damn, baby, I'm fiending. I'm trying to holler at you, I'm screaming. No hip hop, let me love you down this evening. Team man, I could be the king and you could be the queen, and my mind's dirty and it don't need cleaning. I love you long time, so you know the meaning. Now come on. Oh, baby, I can't come down, so please come help me out. Feel it, yeah. You got me feeling high, and I can't step off the cloud. And what? Just can't get enough. Let us feel it. Come on. About it every night. And day singing's good for you. It helps your brain be happy, right? Jump inside your love. It's true. Releases serotonin in the brain. I wouldn't want to have it any other way. I'm addicted and I just can't get enough. Now feel it, come on. I just can't get enough. Say it like you mean it. I just can't get enough. Feel it in your toes. I just can't get enough. Shout it with pride. Just can't get enough. Wow, all right. Very good. That was a fair sing-along there. Thank you for participating. So this is a Black Eyed Peas song. How many of you have heard this song before? Show of hands. Okay, so obviously not an unknown song to you. In this song, Black Eyed Peas are singing about, you know, like relationships and stuff. Yeah, and it starts off and one of their lyrics says, oh baby, I can't come down, so please come help me out. You got me feeling high and I can't step off the cloud. What do you think this is supposed to mean? Yeah, it makes you feel really good, right? Say what? Oh, they're smoking. You think it's about like getting high, actually.
Oh, yeah,
yeah, it might be, right? I mean, maybe. But I mean, the lyric really is about like, I'm high on a cloud because we're in this relationship. You ever heard you're high on cloud
nine?
So you've heard this before, right? The idea is that you're on the cloud and you're like, oh my gosh, I'm on the cloud. And like, it's so great on the cloud. And you look at people who aren't on the cloud and you go, so sad you're not on the cloud, right? And you just keep being happy. And this, the idea about this, right, is actually really common in popular culture, because what it's saying is that a good relationship is going to be passionate, it's going to be intense, it's going to be fun, and it's going to be amazing. It's going to be fun, it's going to be amazing. Yeah, that's what a good relationship is going to be like. Does this sound realistic as to what relationships are really going to be like over the long haul? No. But here we are singing songs like this. If you don't listen to Black Eyed Peas, I promise you, pull out your iPhone, pull out your Droid, and you pull up 10 songs that you listen to on a regular basis, and you and I both know you're going to come across the same basic idea about relationships, about romance. It's in every country song. It's in pretty much every genre of music that exists outside of like classical music that has no lyrics, right? But I mean, it's in almost every lyric to music. Yeah? And then the song goes on and says, I can't get enough. Boy, I think about it every night and day. I have a question for you. Is it good to think about anything every night and day?
No,
that's really unhealthy and obsessive, right? I'm addicted, want to jump inside your love. I don't know what jumping inside someone's love means. It sounds like an easy way to hurt yourself, I think. But I know what I'm addicted means. How many of you hear the word addiction and you're like, awesome? Anyone? No, right? Now you might say like, oh, I'm addicted to chocolate, or I'm addicted to video games, or I'm addicted to football, I'm addicted to Pacers basketball, whatever, right? But if you say you're addicted, I want you to ask yourself a very simple question. The question is this. Do you enjoy the thing you say you're addicted to? And if the answer is yes, you're not addicted. Why? Because when you're addicted to something, you can't really find joy in it. You can't find happiness in that thing. Why? Because you can never get enough. Does that sound like a good way to talk about relationships? Does that sound like a healthy way to describe relationships? No. Should relationships be like an addiction? No, I just can't get enough. 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 Does this sound like a healthy relationship or a stalker?
Stalker.
And I'm not using that term playfully. There's nothing funny about stalking. And in fact, you all should never use the word stalking or stalker unless you are really being serious about it, because it is terrifying and dangerous stuff, right? I'm still stalking you right now. No, following is creepy enough. You don't have to use the word stalking, okay? I just can't get enough. I just can't get enough. What this shows us is something very simple. And it's a model that pop culture shows us constantly, right? You said people get ideas about relationships from media. I mean, we're talking about like the height thing even, right? That imagery comes out of media. What is it that pop culture tells you and me about relationships? It says that when person one and person two come together, that they complete each other. They complete each other. Does this sound realistic?
Just a reminder that all juniors are to report to the library during their resource. Again, all juniors, please report to the library during your resource.
Have you ever heard this idea that people like complete each other, that they make each other whole, that they're two peas in a pod, that you're their better half? You heard these things before?
Yeah.
Yes, I certainly have, right? And is this, can anyone complete you? No. Who is the only person that could theoretically complete you?
Jesus.
No. And like you said Jesus, but that's actually not even accurate, right? Because the work is not his, it's yours to do, isn't it? Right? I mean, you think about it, right? And the whole idea of that is that you do that. right? You make choices about who you are, right? That's who completes you, you. The real model should be this. Person one and person two come together, and what they gain out of it, right? What they gain out of it is something beneficial, but they get to stay who they are. You don't lose yourself in someone else. That sounds unhealthy. That sounds abusive almost. Like, we gotta be together all the time. You shouldn't see anyone else. We're gonna be like, we're gonna be the best of friends. And like, well, I'm your boyfriend. You shouldn't talk to other people. You shouldn't be with other people. I don't know, you've heard or seen this, but I've seen this. Obviously, you nod in your head that you've seen it too. But I'll give you another example. How many of you read Twilight or watched Twilight films? Anyone? Yeah? How many of you did but won't admit it? Show of hands. Yeah, that's what I thought, right? So you don't want to admit it. But so Twilight, right? This is what in the book, right? In the book, this is what. There's so many sounds in this school. This is what the book says, right? Like Bella says to Edward, she says, "You're my life now." Right? Does that sound healthy? No. Could anyone be? Should anyone be your entire life? No. That's a lot of pressure. Think about it. That's a lot of pressure, right? I have to be your entire life. Don't you want someone? You're like the person you're with to have other friends. I mean, don't you get bored of people eventually? Yeah. Then Edward says this to Bella, okay? "Before you, Bella, my life was like a moonless night, very dark, but there were stars and points of light and reason. And then you shot across my sky like a meteor. Everything, suddenly everything was on fire. There was brilliancy, there was beauty. When you were gone, when the meteor had fallen over the horizon, everything went black. Nothing had changed, but my eyes were blinded by the light. I couldn't see the stars anymore, and there was no more reason for anything." Right? It's a vampire. I was just throwing that in, right? A vampire. Does this sound... What the hell do those things mean? How do y'all keep track of that? They just keep buzzing you all day. Does this sound healthy?
No.
How many people do you think... How many of you know someone who would think that this kind of stuff is kind of romantic? Show of hands. Know someone who would think this is kind of romantic. So almost all of you are saying you know someone who thinks it's romantic, but when I ask you, is it healthy? You were like, no. Right away, you know it's not healthy, right? Because it seems like, oh, there's nothing in the world without you, right? I'll give you an example from the show Scandal.
"I wait for you. I watch for you. My whole life is you. I can't breathe because I'm waiting for you. You own me. You control me. I belong to you.
You own me. You control me. I belong to you. Do you think I want to be a better man? You think that I don't want to dedicate myself to my marriage? People think I want to be honorable to be the man that you voted for? I love you. I'm in love with you. You're the love of my life. My every feeling is controlled by the look on your face. I can't breathe without you. I can't sleep without you. I wait for you. I watch for you. I exist for you. If I could escape all of this, I'm going to wait with you. There's no Sally and Thomas here. You're nobody's victim, Liz. I belong to you. We're in this together.
I belong to you. You belong to me. You're my sweetheart. I belong to you. Does that sound, even that, sound healthy if you really think about it? No, it makes it sound like the other person is what?
A slave.
A slave, your possession. Think about that, right? How many times have you heard people say that? How many songs have that in it? You belong to me, I belong to you, right? I mean, you've heard it, you've seen it. And then in this clip, right, he's like, oh, you control me. I can't breathe without you. I can't sleep without you. I can't think without you. And I don't know about you, but when I hear that, I'm like, yo, you should probably talk to someone about that. You know, like go see a therapist or something, bro, because that sounds pretty messed up. But is that what this is supposed to be, or is it what he's saying supposed to be romantic? It's supposed to be romantic. And you may be thinking to yourself, like, I get it, Jeff, okay? I totally get it. Like, I'm not stupid. Pop culture isn't messing with my head like that because I'm smart, okay? And I don't know why I turned you into, like, a California Valley girl. But you may be thinking that right now. And I want to tell you something. If you're thinking that, it's actually messing with you more than anyone else. This is not a question of if the things you consume are affecting you. The only question is how. How do the magazines you look at affect the way that you view women or view men? Right? How many guys in this room have looked at Maxim magazine? How many times has that impacted the way that you view women? How many times have you looked and watched TV and seen what romance is supposed to be? And in your head, where else do you learn what it is? And so you try to act it out. How many of you have known someone who was disappointed because their partner didn't say things like, you're my everything, I love you, without you I'd die. I mean, like, people are like, well, you don't love me then. Well, I mean, like, we get into this place where this stuff is in your head. It's in my head, even. And I'm a professor, and I study it for a living, and it affects me. You're not able to outsmart this. There's no, like, it's not about how intelligent you are, how clever you are. It's already affecting you. Ask yourself a question. You want to be smart. Here's the question to ask. How is it messing with my head? What ideas from this do I actually use? And which ones are helpful and which ones aren't? Some of them might be good, but a lot of them won't be. How many things in the clip we just watched would you say fit into this healthy relationship wheel? So this is like a healthy relationship diagram, and in this diagram we've got this idea of like positive things in relationships, right? What makes relationships good? It was, I was asking you when we started, right? When you were like, what's fun? And you said hanging out, and I got on you a little bit about that. These are the things that you started to describe. What in the things we've just watched, in the songs we've watched, matches this? Well, you got, I mean, like in the Scandal clip, you got to give him honesty, right? He was honest, right? You control everything I'm thinking, you know, like, that's honest, at least, right? Letting her know that he's crazy. But I mean, really, what you see up here, these are the things that are supposed to be positive. And I mean, look up here, you tell me, do you think that in a friendship, and certainly in a romantic relationship, that these things are actually important, that they are healthy, they are good, yeah? Okay, so where are they in what we watch? Where are they in how we talk about relationships? How often have you actually had a conversation with a friend about what respect actually looks like? Not the word, but what it actually looks like in your relationship or in other people's relationship. When you start dating someone, do you talk about how to be honest and respectful at the same time? Have you ever had that conversation where you sat down with someone and said, like, your new girlfriend, your new boyfriend, and you're like, so, like, you know, I mean, like, we're kind of like dating now and stuff, and you're like, no, stuff just happens. You just live life. We don't spend time talking about stuff, right? It's like, but then you're not doing the very thing that you're telling me is healthy. Somehow, even though so many of you come from healthy homes, not all of you, but so many of you come from healthy homes, maybe you've seen healthy relationships, yet somehow you and I don't practice these things all that much. We forget to practice them because we're buying into the idea of what relationships are supposed to be. I asked a bunch of students in San Diego what phrases they use to talk about relationships, and these were some of the samples that they gave me. So it's not just in pop culture. You've heard these phrases used too. And a lot of these phrases make it seem like the other person completes you, like the other person, you die without them. The other person is all you have in the world. And people say these things out loud, and it's part of how we learn to do relationships. And what I'm asking you to do is to question that. I'm not saying you have to throw it all out, but if I'm sure you all think you're smart people, you want to be criminal justice people, you're in a class like this, use your critical thinking skills as such. Right? Don't just take what the environment is giving you. Ask, does that serve a healthy relationship? And if the phrase is actually not making things more healthy, then why are you using it? If those words that you use to push people into boxes are actually not healthy, why are you using them? Why do it? I'm going to skip that one. I think I've got... What's up next? Ah, okay. Got another advertisement here for you, actually. Oh, that's not the one I wanted. I don't want that one. I don't want that one. I don't want that one. I want... In fact, I'm going to skip this right here. This is the definition of relationship abuse. A pattern of abusive, controlling, and coercive behaviors, including these other things, against a partner or an intimate partner, like someone you're romantic with or in a relationship with. Yeah? And now I want to show you a video and music clip that you've undoubtedly heard.
Right now, still like,
of you have heard this song before? I'd argue this is actually the most popular song of the last decade. It is almost impossible to find someone who hasn't heard this song, and it still plays on every pop channel in the country at least once or twice a week. It is an incredibly popular song, very famous. And Eminem and Rihanna are interesting people to sing this song, right? Eminem, if you're not aware of it, has been arrested for domestic violence multiple times for abusing his wife, or his girlfriend, then his wife. And then Rihanna, if you're not familiar, was a victim of domestic violence with Chris Brown, who injured her before an awards show once. And I want you to look up here and read the lyric of this song again with me, because I'm sure that many of you sang the song out loud. I certainly did. Maybe that's what happens when a tornado meets a volcano. What do you think that's supposed to mean? Say what? They're both natural disasters, right? And what is it, like, what are natural disasters? What is, like, what's a...
Problems.
Okay, yeah, so they're both very serious problems. Are they disastrous? Yeah, I mean, they're destructive, yeah? What about natural disasters is unique, though, in terms of, like, what we can do about disasters? Say it again? You can't control a natural disaster, can't you? You can't stop a volcano from erupting. You can't stop a tornado from forming. And so this lyric is very informative in the sense that it tells us what? That this is out of their
control.
Is that true, that this is out of their control?
No.
Abuse is a choice. Yeah? A choice that people make.